Why was John's gospel written? My title is Stay on the Bus or Staying on the Bus, Reading John's Gospel as Pastoral Theology. Why was John's gospel written? That is the subject of this short paper. One might conclude that by reading John 20:31, the matter would be settled. These are the texts. A brief comparison of the New Revised Standard Version and the RSV hints at the possibility of different readings. RSV has, "These are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God," etc., etc. NRS reads, "But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God." And for those Greek fanatics, the Greek text is below. NRS attempts to address the manuscript evidence for the existence of faith, or belief, as a present or aorist subjunctive at 2031. That is, come to believe, or believe, or continue to believe, depending on how you render that. The relative forces of which can make a substantial difference to the way this verse is understood, and by virtue of its programmatic character, perhaps why the Gospel of John was written in the first place. While one is generally reluctant to hang more weight than a sentence can bear, in this case the verse speaks to the question of purpose in the written Gospel itself. If anyone has viewed baseball games, for example, on TV, the inescapable presence of John 3:16, for example, scrawled on a placard in a strategically located place in the stands, clearly suggests that the spectator considers John's gospel to be, in general, a suitable text for evangelistic purposes, quite apart from the possibility that John 3:16 itself is not actually self-evident, as it may appear to be. So I'm sure that many people viewing the game are unlikely to immediately reach for their New Testaments to confirm that these things are so. Be that as it may, the observation of the commonly held view that John's gospel was written primarily for those outside the community of Christian faith is, in my view, open to question. NRS and RSV appear to contend that that is in fact the case. I seek to argue that the best translation is the present aorist and that it should be rendered, "But these are written that you may continue to believe that Jesus is the Christ," etc. I say this because I think that the evidence is supported by intrinsic and extrinsic probabilities. Extrinsic because the manuscript evidence is broad, and early scribal corrections point to an appreciation of the problem. In other words, many very early high pedigree manuscripts opt for the present tense rather than the aorist. Intrinsic because, in fact, and more subjectively perhaps, a fair reading of John's gospel suggests a lower likelihood that a reader having traversed John would move from a position of no faith, or perhaps honest inquiry, to actual faith at some level. John, in short, is polemical. If I was Jewish, would I really be motivated to become a Christian as a result of reading John's gospel? Well, hey, that's me, perhaps not. However, Johannine sarcasm and satire, which touches so many parts of the fourth gospel, would not in general endear itself to a reader any more than it might us, should we be seeking to be influenced. Likewise, John assumes considerable knowledge of Jewish piety to the extent that he sometimes has to explain it to his readers. So this raises the question, why was John written? As an evangelistic enterprise to inculcate belief or stimulate belief, or as a more pastoral document intended perhaps to strengthen Christians who may entertain thoughts of rejecting Christ, in fact, leaving the church through neglect or lack of theological integrity. And quickly moving on. Okay, leave that for a minute or two. The detailed linguistic arguments presented in the debate by Gordon Fee and D.A. Carson favor the present subjunctive, as Nestle 27 and 28, UBS 4, are reticent in their judgments and assign it, the textual option to the present subjunctive at a C level of relative uncertainty, which, although not high, seems to dominate the text. In a 1987 article, D.A. Carson contends that 2031 may, quote, have a role to play as an aid to the interpreter's grasp of John's themes or language, but not as a contribution to an assessment of the author's purpose in writing the gospel in the first place. But actually, why not? Why would a wedge be driven between John's language and his motivations for writing, since all we actually happen to have is his writing? While it may be the case that, according to Carson, only a very small number of scholars appeal to this verse in support of the thesis that the fourth gospel is primarily evangelistic, we need to bear in mind that scholars are not the only ones who read and attempt to understand the gospels. Indeed, Carson himself, in his own preliminary 1987 essay, thinks an evangelistic purpose for John is actually viable, because apparently anything can be if the context and situation can use it. So he must therefore include himself in this select reading group. Of course, this is a fail-safe conclusion. The argument ultimately amounts to God can do anything. Any debate, perhaps. God can do anything, but it doesn't mean that God does do anything. As is always the case, a few test assumptions need to be made. During the 70s and 80s, it was thought possible and necessary to reconstruct the identity and circumstances of the Johannine community that might have given rise to such a unique expression of the gospel. Rudolf Bultmann, C.H. Dodd, Raymond Brown, Barnabas Linders, Alan Culpepper represent but a few scholars who have sought to bring precision to this enterprise. It is natural to proceed in this way because the content of John would seem itself to demand it. For whom does John write? Quite apart from John's relationship to the synoptic tradition, the particularity of Johannine polemic and John's portrayal of Jesus offers the reader significant challenges for historicity and reconstruction. Naturally, the problem with all reconstructions is the fact that they are reconstructions, and one may be more or less persuaded accordingly. I'm typically the only person that believes my own reconstructions. Further, one may ask whether John is taken to be writing as a response to local concerns which posed a more systematic threat to the integrity of the church and its message. The situation is compounded by the elusive and allusive dimensions of John's style, not least by his more tantalizing, ambiguous, and seemingly parenthetic remarks that appear to add little to his burden for writing. The search for the Johannine community was a worthy project, though it did not offer secure results, because the net had too close a mesh. Casting about more widely, another assumption, that is, John's gospel is conceptually linked with the Johannine epistles, though we say nothing about Revelation at this point. The epistles' burden is the more general concern of what constitutes orthodoxy, a greatly preferable term than most other labels these days, and one that has outlasted everything else. It is not the community itself, but its internal fidelity that is at stake. Its ethics are situated in a dynamic commitment to what is true. The community arises from that, not the other way around, in modern understanding, which is actually faintly idolatrous regarding community. Naturally, this involves discussions of authority and the guardianship of the kerygma. Nevertheless, people do leave faith. They actually fall away, they leave. They reject the gospel in favor of something more amenable, or else the gospel's demands become onerous. People leave the church. And anyone familiar with Reginald Bibby these days, or in the last decade or so, can hardly escape the statistics. At this point, a caveat: there is no one factor ever decisive in resolving an interpretive issue. Usually, we look for a preponderance of probabilities to achieve a plausible reading. However, this creates its own logic problem. Under such circumstances of reconstruction, certainty levels drop dramatically. For example, three probabilities required for an argument at 80% probability don't result in the final probability of 80%. They result in a probability of 52.1%, which is considerably less. In other words, logic probabilities are multiplicative, not additive. So it raises a problem for the cumulative impact of argumentation. And that's the problem we have here. So what should we do? A couple of things. First, we have a text before us which is a living, breathing thing because it exists not merely in a linear relationship of ink-shaped shapes on a page, but rather it exists in a somewhat ontological relationship with its readers. It's not itself a mathematical equation. Embedded in the text is the person who wrote it, and writers can do whatever they want. Paul as much as says that, "My letter is my presence among you." They do not necessarily share the same rigorous logic of mathematicians. Secondly, however, readers of the Bible have understood their English translations to privilege the reading of an aorist subjunctive at 2031. Maybe I could move back, actually, and remind you of these things. Consequently, despite the fact that our critical editions, such as UBS 4, although covering all bets by placing the sigma in parenthesis, and you can see it on the bottom text, look for a little square brackets, within the word, thus reading that you may believe. Consequently, John's purpose and broad motivation in writing is believed to point to an audience that knows not Christ with a view to their acceptance of the gospel. Hence, brandishing something like John 3:16 willy-nilly, believing this to be consistent with John's purpose because that's what their English text says, seems to me pointless and unhelpful. So I urge that such an intent is actually not the case. John is not usable as an evangelistic text. There, said it. I urge that such a wider reading strategy that broadens our textual sample size is needed. This could be termed a canonical reading of Scripture, an old method and one loved by the reformers who thought that Scripture was the best interpretation of Scripture. The rabbis did this by explicating complex text through ones that were more readily understood. So that's something of what I aim for. Assume that John writes to keep people from rejecting a gospel that they have previously trusted. Perhaps they have done so because of external socio-religious pressures. We know that such pressures existed, as they do now. John, as a pastor, therefore views this with considerable alarm. He observes local churches struggling to maintain their distinctive beliefs and sometimes failing. People leave. People always have. To become a Christian is not in itself hard, but to remain true to the gospel in an unsympathetic world that offers a spectrum of religious options is more difficult because the mystery of the gospel has deep ontic implications of theosis and participation in the Godhead. So this being the case in the Greco-Roman world, we might expect that sort of problem to manifest itself in other parts of the New Testament at least, unless John, of course, is responding to a highly localized problem. But in fact, in the New Testament, the problem is everywhere. For instance, even in the strange and very unusual chapter 6 of John's Gospel, in verse 60, many of his disciples, when they heard Jesus teaching, said, "This is a hard saying. Who can listen to it?" Jesus said to them, "Do you take offense at this? What if you were to see the Son of Man ascending where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is of no avail. But there are some among you who do not believe." And so on and so on. Verse 66, after this, many of his disciples drew back and no longer went about with them. Jesus said to the 12, "Do you also wish to go away?" Simon Peter said, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life." There isn't simply time at all to do much more than that, but the Johannine literature itself, both the Gospel and the Epistles, are simply vibrate with this lurking, perhaps even sinister sense that, in fact, staying on the bus, remaining true to one's faith and convictions in Christ is not a given. Although such concerns surface throughout the New Testament, they appear to be particularly acute in the Johannine corpus. For example, the seven letters, well, I said I wouldn't mention Revelation, but there you go, did that too. The seven letters in Revelation, one could argue that it is consistent with the patterns of covenant disobedience to be found in both Pentateuch and prophets alike. In other words, it's nothing new. But John is a pastor, an elder, an apostle, may we assume. He cannot remain indifferent to the fate of the church, and in his own way is as incredulous as Paul in Galatians at the willingness of persons to reject what they know and understand to be life in favor of a way that ultimately leads to death. So far as the fourth gospel is concerned, John creates a multidimensional rhetorical and imaginative world. His narrative creativity plays upon the reader's sensibilities to such a degree that one feels bound up not only with John's polemics, but with the one who precipitates such polemics. Life and death in John, dark and light, love and hate, and so on, abiding, not abiding. And so John achieves this by creating a set of dramatic binaries and oppositions, as I've just suggested. One such binary involves the juxtaposition of the traditions of Moses with his claim that Jesus supersedes Moses through acts of fulfillment and scriptural congruence. Naturally, within a framework of Jewish piety and Greco-Roman politics, such claims produced various responses. Still, with this said, is it really the best way to bring to light the claims of Christ to those for whom John's style is a challenge? Well, perhaps if they already had that capacity, such as those within the church who had been catechized and brought to a place of repentance, belief, and baptism, and admission to the sacred mysteries. They had been exposed to the language and imagination of the gospel, but now, for whatever reasons, found it untenable. That's a very serious breach, in John's mind. And so the binaries of life and death, truth and lie, and so on, are perfectly congruent in that sort of context. Dramatic, to be sure. So under such circumstances, it is not hard to read the Johannine posture as polemical, sarcastic, hortatory, and so on, if the unity and integrity of the ecclesia was at stake. And so this returns us to the problem. Why did John write at all? If one could sketch out the sort of community of which he was part, either directly or more remotely, by virtue of personal authority, and without making prior commitments to the identity of the writer as John the Apostle, although I don't think that's in principle ruled out, since we know so little of the date of just about anything other than First Thessalonians and First Corinthians, it might be easier to imagine a set of conditions that could give rise to such a text. Numerous suggestions have been made to depict the theological dimensions of such circumstances, typically addressing convictions surrounding the divine identity of Jesus and his self-understanding, not least the ethical outcomes and imperatives arising from this. John clearly writes from a position of authority, and so it is necessary to ask what he thought was at stake for the future of the Christian community and its message. That question of purpose is by no means settled, is demonstrated by the regular flow of books, articles, monographs that probe the matter, but of nonetheless fundamental importance. Indeed, this may be the central issue and the most elusive one. Is there consensus to purpose, as to purpose? To a limited extent, yes, but typically with caveats that hang upon the reconstructed nature of the hypothetical Johannine community derived from a construal of John's polemic, specifically aimed at Jesus' relationship with Jewish religious authority. This aspect of John cannot be dismissed as it forms a consistent platform for the Johannine plot structure. However, it does not fully explain why John chose to write in such a way as to make ambiguity a key reading strategy if all that was at stake was a simple rebuttal of Jewish antagonism demonstrating that Jesus was superior to Moses and from which Jesus' self-authentication could be deduced if only a reader had but an open mind. In other words, if you want to convince somebody that Jesus is the Messiah, I'm not sure you would actually write John's gospel. You might write Mark or Luke or Matthew, but I'm not sure it would be John. But if you wanted to bring somebody back to a position that had been previously held, to arrest the fragmentation of ecclesial communities, then yes, John starts to make sense in that, dare I say, reconstructed context. So in this way, John 20:31 is frequently read, while it is read frequently as an evangelical appeal intended to move the reader from a place of skepticism and unbelief as to what, for example, Jesus' divinity, saving significance as God's son, worthy of worship without anxiety over questions of blasphemy, radical rejection of the supremacy of Moses and hence Torah even, to one of faith and discipleship and why this matters. To be sure, these leading contentions are present everywhere in John, and the record of Jesus' collisions with Greco-Roman Palestinian Judaism appears self-evident, but again the question arises as to why John's gospel can be thought to achieve the evangelical imperative among unbelievers. Compared to Luke's measured and reasonable declaration of purpose with where Theophilus is expected to be fully informed and Paul's restrained and careful opportunistic address on Mars Hill in Acts 17, at least as Luke reconstructs it, John's purpose is complex to an astounding degree if conflict with those outside the ecclesia is the urgent need. It's not the urgent need. Inside the ecclesia is the urgent need, hence John. So as a compelling argument to believe and have faith in Christ where none previously existed, it isn't clear how John's sophisticated polemic would accomplish this, unless, of course, John's concept of unbelief primarily targets life inside the church. Whoops, people don't really believe inside the church. Well, yes, that's really true. Primarily targets life inside the church, not life outside it. However, that I want to suggest is a challenge for another occasion, but for the time being, I invite you to stay on the bus. Thanks a lot.